Emily Chang in San Francisco, and this is Bloomberg Technology. Coming up in the next hour, big tech power under fire. The CEOs of Facebook, Google, Twitter defending their policies on Capitol Hill today, but lawmakers, especially Republicans, blasting the platforms for bias and censorship. We will have all the details and the most heated exchanges. Plus, relocation. Reddit has a progressive plan to let its employees work from wherever they are. But what are the unintended consequences of such an arrangement? We're going to ask Reddit CEO Steve Huffman. And election threat. The U.S. has already identified Iran and Russia for meddling in the election. We're going to talk about how pervasive the menace is and its potential harmful effect on democracy in our continuing electioneering series. But first, it was an ugly day for U.S. markets. The S&P 500 tumbling in the worst stock rout in 4 months. Rising cases of COVID-19 across the U.S. and Europe, as well as new lockdown measures in countries like Germany and France, accelerating the drop. I want to get the big picture from Bloomberg's Abigail Doolittle in New York. Abigail, a lot of forces at move today. Walk us through the headlines.
Certainly a lot of forces at work today, and overall a brutal day for stocks and risk assets on a combined basis. And, you know, you're mentioning these different forces. Of course, there is the uncertainty around the election, but I would argue that the bigger force on today's selling pressure, certainly those virus resurgence in Europe, the selling action was pretty brutal. The German DAX fell more than 4%. Its worst day since March 18th. And that fear around the virus and what a resurgence and future lockdowns could do to the economy really hit stocks hard here in the U.S. The S&P 500 down 3.5%, as you were mentioning, the worst day since early June. The worst sector for the S&P 500, this year's defensive sector, not so defensive today, Emily. The S&P 500 tech index down 4.3%, the FANG index down more than 4%, the SOX chips down 3.4%. So folks want out of what has worked this year, that defense really not working all that well on the day. That was the bearish action. And again, it really seems to have more to do with the virus. At this point, we will have more information, of course, as trading action goes on. But the S&P 500 has breached key technical levels, similar to some of those European indexes, suggesting more selling could be ahead. So stay tuned for that sort of volatility. As for some earnings movers after hours, we do have a little bit of a reprieve here, actually a pretty big one with Pinterest. Take a look at that. Absolutely soaring, up 29%. They put up a big beat and driving their strength, Emily, digital ad sales. So similar to Snap, it seems like these companies that have digital ad sales on the internet doing very well. Clearly consumers on the internet during this pandemic time when they're at home more so than not. eBay, on the other hand, they beat estimates for the last quarter, but for the current quarter, they're saying that it's not going to be so great or not as great as hoped for the holiday quarter, that stock falling on weak guidance. And then Etsy right now down 1.2%. Not entirely clear what's behind that, Emily, because they actually beat, and not surprisingly, they sell those homemade masks. But, you know, it could have to do with the fact that the stock up so much, just not strong enough. Investors taking some chips off the table, especially in the wake of the day that we had. That sort of fear tends to keep that in motion, and folks want only the very, very best.
Interesting. All of those e-commerce holiday stories to watch as well over the next few weeks. I was also watching the hearing on Capitol Hill today. Facebook CEO Mark Zuckerberg, Sundar Pichai of Google, Twitter CEO Jack Dorsey, all in the hot seat. All of them also reporting results later this week, along with Apple and Amazon. What are you expecting?
So, you know, it's pretty interesting. That testimony definitely very colorful in terms of language as these big tech internet CEOs are trying to defend the Section 230 that protects their companies and lawmakers obviously going against them or trying to bring something about. But in terms of any sort of change that would actually affect the numbers or the fundamentals for these companies anytime soon from this testimony, that's unlikely. So the bigger picture really is what you were talking about, earnings tomorrow for Apple, Amazon, Alphabet, Facebook. And, you know, something that's interesting going into this report, Twitter as well, we have huge selling pressure. These were the big drags on the day. The stocks that have worked this year, investors taking chips off the table, perhaps profits where it's been working. But it's also interesting, Emily, because over the last 5 days, these stocks are down as well. When you don't have stocks trading well into the reports, sometimes it can raise a red flag. plus price to perfection. That bar is very high because these are the companies that have done well. So any kind of hiccup from these companies, you could see some serious selling pressure. And today's red may be some sort of a small tell on that, that investors are at least shaving some of their risk off into those reports.
All right, Bloomberg's Abigail Doolittle, thank you so much for that update. As Abigail was discussing the biggest names report tomorrow after the close, Apple, Amazon, Alphabet, and Facebook, also those big tech CEOs on Capitol Hill. Earlier today, the CEOs of Alphabet, Facebook, and Twitter. Joining us now, Ben Brody, who covers tech lobbying in Washington, was watching every minute of these hearings, just as I was. Ben, what do you think the main takeaway was here? Obviously, we knew there was going to be a lot of political fireworks right ahead of the election, 6 days away. But this one was a lot more colorful than some of the testimony we've seen in the past.
Yeah, I took the partisan theater to be one of the main takeaways. Of course, in 6 days, these platforms are going to face really their biggest test. There's going to be a lot of disinformation. There may be claims, false claims of having won states or the entire election. And it was interesting to see how they tried to stand up to Republican or Democratic pressure to basically treat certain kinds of content, particularly election or political content, certain ways. The tension was definitely high. There was, frankly, it seemed like a fair amount of anger from the lawmakers, and that really came through. I think the platforms are trying to parry that and trying to assure, particularly the Democrats, that they're going to play this one down the line and keep disinformation off the platforms. But it remains to be seen in less than a week whether or not they're going to be able to do that.
So let's take a listen to some of what we heard earlier today and some of the more heated exchanges between the lawmakers and the CEO. Take a listen.
So you're testifying to this committee right now that Twitter, when it silences people, when it censors people, when it blocks political speech, that has no impact on elections?
People have choice of other communication channels with which...
Not if they don't hear information. If you don't think you have the power to influence elections, why do you block anything?
Well, we have policies that are focused on making sure that more voices on the platform are possible. We see a lot of abuse and harassment, which ends up silencing people and having them leave from the platform.
We do continue to see coordinated influence operation attempts. We've been very vigilant. We appreciate the cooperation we get from intelligence agencies, and as companies, we are sharing information.
We can't stop countries like Russia from trying to interfere in an election. Only the U.S. government can really push back and with the appropriate leverage to do that. But we have built up systems to make sure that we can identify much faster when they're attempting to do that. And I think that should give the American people a good amount of confidence leading into this election.
So look, Ben, let's remind folks why this hearing was called in the first place. It was about Section 230, which protects these companies from legal liability for content that their users post. Some Republicans wanted to focus more on how Twitter and Facebook have handled particular posts from the president, have handled the New York Post story about Hunter and Joe Biden. In terms of what we heard today, how will this impact the actual law, and will that law be changed?
Yeah, you know, it was a very interesting pretext because Section 230 was very little discussed. There was one comment sort of in the middle of the hearing about what some of the Republican proposals on 230 might do. And there was a comment from Mark Zuckerberg toward the end about wanting changes to maybe tackle the issue of transparency. So it really doesn't focus on that. What I think you're seeing is that issue, Section 230, which has really come under bipartisan criticism, is increasingly going back in the other direction. It's splaying out, and you have a set of Republican criticisms and a set of Democratic criticisms, and they're largely opposite. And unless the lawmakers can find a way to come back together, obviously this would be in the next Congress, potentially with a different set of who is in power. It's going to be really hard for them to advance, I think, anything that really changes how this law and how it treats the tech companies.
Right. Republicans concerned about too much moderation, Democrats concerned about not enough, and a big election standing between now and when this will be revisited. So, of course, we'll continue to follow this story. Ben, thanks so much for your expert commentary. Bloomberg's Ben Brody from Washington. All right, coming up, we're going to get more on the tech hearings from a longtime tech in Silicon Valley veteran. Should these companies be held accountable? Do they have too much power? That is next. This is Bloomberg. As we've been following all day, major tech CEOs in the hot seat before Congress today, fighting allegations of negligence and bias. The heads of Facebook, Google, and Twitter all facing tough questions from lawmakers about how they are handling political speech and misinformation with just 6 days to go until the election. Joining us for more on how the tech regulatory landscape has changed, tech veteran Tom Siebel, C3.ai founder and CEO, which makes AI software. He also founded Siebel Systems back in 1993, one of the most iconic makers of early software in Silicon Valley, so has quite the interesting historical perspective on this. Tom, I'd love to get your thoughts on the pressure that is now facing Facebook, Google, and Twitter. Do these companies have too much power?
Well, I think this is an unusual example of the United States government stepping up and doing its job. We have a situation where we have these social media companies have become more powerful than the governments that regulate them. Okay, the utilities that they provide are becoming a substantial public health hazard. They are being weaponized by bad actors, and they are being manipulated by the people that run these companies to filter the information that's made available to voters and to the citizens at large. So, you know, this power is being abused. And I think if this is a situation where if government does not regulate, we will be very sorry.
Give us some historical context and how different the competitive landscape is today than it was when you started Siebel Systems back in the day.
Well, I think I think the idea that you're going to compete against Facebook or you're going to compete against Google, I think it's, you know, highly unlikely. I think people today don't really start companies to compete with Google. They start companies with the hope of being acquired by Google. So I think these are juggernauts that are insurmountable. You know, whether or not there's an antitrust issue or not, you know, that is kind of beyond my pay grade. I'm not a lawyer. I don't know this. Okay. But I do know that these companies are misusing their power. They're misusing AI in you know, really malicious ways in terms of manipulating people, causing, you know, public health hazard amongst teenagers, allowing bad actors to weaponize these systems to manipulate elections. And they are most clearly, certainly filtering the information that's available to voters so that voters are unable to make well-informed decisions because they are not being given the news.
So you do think this influences the election and the results, the way that these companies operate?
Unquestionably, they're influencing the election. They know that they're influencing the election. They know exactly how they're doing it. They're doing it with forethought. I don't think it's malice because they think they're doing the right thing, but they absolutely know exactly what they're doing. They have an agenda, and they want to overthrow the current government, and they're doing a pretty good job of it.
So let's talk about what you're working on now, because you are working on a new generation of AI software. We hear these CEOs often refer to technology and AI as a way to take bias out of the process. But the reality is that people make these algorithms. So what's the way forward?
Well, most of what we do, so C3.ai, I believe, is the world's leading provider of commercial and industrial AI systems. And these are done for process optimization, inventory optimizations, logistics in the military, AI-based predictive maintenance for aircraft, what have you. And precision health, for example, in COVID. And the social and economic benefits of these systems are simply staggering. Now, most of these systems, we're just dealing with physics, okay? Pressure, altitude, torque, rotational velocity. So there are no bias in the data. It's simply physical, natural phenomena. Now, where we get into the intersection of AI and social systems, we really need to think hard about bias that are in the data. Think about criminal justice. Think about using AI for human resource systems. And it is unquestionable there that there are our cultural bias in these data, and that cultural bias will simply be perpetuated by the use of AI. So I think this is, you know, this is a real danger zone, and we need to be very careful about the use of AI as it relates to criminal justice, facial recognition, human resource systems. This is very touchy, very dangerous stuff.
Interesting. What do you think makes your offering better than, for example, what Salesforce has to offer?
Well, Salesforce, I think, is a CRM product. And to my knowledge, they're not in the enterprise AI business. I think, you know, everybody talks
about... Well, they do have their own AI offering called Einstein. They also bought MuleSoft, which connects, you know, more disparate data sources. So I guess the question is, how does C3.ai differ from the competition on the market?
Okay, MuleSoft is, to be clear, it's a number of connectors. Einstein claims that its AI solution suggests to the salesperson what the next best step in a sales process. Well, that's fine and dandy, but that's not an AI problem. Okay, what we solve are AI problems where we're taking the data, massive amounts of data from oil and gas companies, manufacturing companies, aerospace companies, the Department of the Air Force, the Department of the Air Force or Army, and building machine learning models that are highly predictive of device failure, production optimization, stochastic optimization of the supply chain, what have you. So those are classic AI problems. The kind of problems that Salesforce claims to claim using AI, it's simply not an AI problem.
All right. Fascinating. Really interesting to get your perspective, given the many years you've spent in Silicon Valley. And we will keep our eye on C3.ai and the important work that you're doing. Thank you. All right. Still ahead. As cases of COVID-19 surge across the U.S. and Europe, multinational companies are steeling themselves and their clients for a potential second wave. We're going to hear insight from Infosys CEO Salil Parekh. This is Bloomberg. European leaders are imposing harsher pandemic measures as cases of COVID-19 resurge across the continent. Today, Germany and France announced fresh lockdown measures designed to slow the pace of infections. Bloomberg's Caroline Hyde spoke with Salil Parekh of Infosys, one of the world's largest IT service providers, about how his company is preparing for a second wave.
Having seen what is going on in the last few days, we know that those sorts of numbers will have some impact. And we know that the way we've looked at our business is taken into account some scenarios of a second wave. We've obviously not considered extreme scenarios at this time. But we'll have to see how this plays out. What we've also noticed is in many geographies, businesses have learned to work with some of this medical crisis. I'm not saying it's going to be possible with extreme sets of numbers, but there are things that are going on. People are using therapeutics, people are using masking, and there are ways people are finding to work and revive the economy, even on a personal level. So we'll wait and watch how this plays out. As of now, we've sort of factored in some scenarios, but not extreme scenarios.
Do you think you will have to factor in extreme scenarios and what you're seeing right now?
At this stage, we don't see that based on what we've seen so far. Of course, the numbers are increasing and there's no question to it. But equally, there's a lot of medical knowledge that exists. I was in a discussion with a European client recently, and they were sharing with us how in different parts of Europe where there are more measures of constraining activity, there's also measures which support them medically. So we have to wait and watch how that plays out. At this stage, we don't think it's going to impact in a negative way from where we've guided.
Talking of European clients, talking of European companies you work alongside, I mean, earlier this week, we had the dreadful numbers coming out of SAP, of course, a key software provider in Germany, which was saying, look, actually, the lockdowns are going to impact their business. They are seeing client reticence to uplift their focus on technology to invest. But really, what's happened with COVID is the work from home focus has strained technology and has been sort of a force for acceleration in terms of that investment. What do you see? Do you see the SAP side of the equation? Do you see in clients putting things off as the economy turns darker? Or do you think that there is commitment to this acceleration?
So there, what we are seeing, Caroline, is large enterprises are going through big digital transformation programs and a rapid move to the cloud. And here we've built a tremendous engine within Infosys, which is our digital business. So in the last quarter, our digital business grew 25% year on year, and it's about just under half, 47% of our company. So what that really means for us is partnerships that we have with cloud providers, where companies are going onto the cloud infrastructure. Those are the sorts of areas where we see more traction, and we are participating in those areas. And that's the benefit of the growth we are seeing. To be clear, our growth guidance is 2% to 3% for the full year. We're not talking about returning to where we were before the medical crisis, where last year we grew at 9.8%, but it's certainly better than what our guidance was before the end of the quarter, at which stage it was 0 to 2%. So we see a gradual expansion in the guidance, more because we see the activity on the cloud and the digital transformation.
Do you think you will get back to 9% growth anytime soon with the economy, the global economy as it stands?
So the way we see that is we have our view for this financial year, which is through March of 2021, and that's the guidance we've given. My sense is, given the momentum we had getting into the crisis, we think as we come out of the crisis, we'll have equal or more momentum, because there's more imperative on large enterprises to push ahead, accelerate with their digital journey. And the more we are able to participate and partner with them, the more likely we are to regain that sort of momentum.
That was Infosys CEO Salil Parekh there. And we do have some breaking news. ByteDance, the parent company of TikTok, has sued rival Triller in a dispute over patents. Triller has come under the Microsoft, a company that has faced allegations of trying to steal some TikTok users. We're going to continue to follow this story and bring you more as headlines roll out. Coming up, more on the big tech hearings and Reddit making big changes to its pay packages. This is Welcome back to Bloomberg Technology. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco. The social platform Reddit says it will allow most of its U.S. employees the flexibility to work remotely forever, with some exceptions. And they will still be paid the same, even if they choose to move out of high-cost cities like San Francisco and New York. This is other tech companies like Facebook, Slack, and VMware, along with Stripe, have decided to pay workers based on their new location. Joining us now for more, Reddit CEO Steve Huffman. So, Steve, this is a really interesting tact here. Traditionally, tech companies have said if you're leaving the expensive Bay Area for a cheaper part of the country, your pay will be adjusted down. You're saying they'll be paid the same. How did you come to this decision?
Sure, that's right. So first, hi, thanks for having me. We had that original policy as well, but it had some obvious flaws, which is, first of all, there are so many decisions, personal decisions that one might make in their life that affect their quality and cost of living, such as whether to have a family, whether to rent or own, what part of the city to live in, and of course, which city you live in. And so there are so many variables at play here. We figured the most fair thing to do is to simply pay at the top of the market and pay for performance and pay for the role. And we think this will be an advantage for both recruiting and just simplify, I think, a lot of what I would call like garbage in, garbage out, you know, math that we were trying to do.
So how many employees do you think will take you up on this offer and move away from headquarters to other parts of the country? And how do you expect that to impact your sort of talent redistribution, if you will?
It's a great question. And if I'm being completely honest, we don't know. We've surveyed our employees and found that only a small percentage like need to be in the office, but many, the vast majority would like to be in the office sometime, but would also like the freedom in their life. And just speaking from my own experience, I think my own feelings have evolved on this. I think there's pros and cons to working from home and working remotely that we're still learning. And so the core of our approach is to be flexible and let people make these decisions, let teams maybe experiment with different approaches. And I'm as curious as you are to see how the dust will settle when all of this is over.
So what does a return to work look like for you when we get to some sort of normal or new normal?
Well, so the first question is it legal to open our offices, right? Given the various restrictions in different cities. So we're not even there yet. And then is it practically safe to open our offices? And then the big question is, do we as employees feel comfortable being in our offices? I think we don't yet know the, you know, how our habits have changed, the PTSD of, you know, being afraid of just being around people generally is going to affect things. So I think no matter what the law says, there's going to be a matter of kind of practicality that will require us to kind of inch our way in and feel our way as we go.
Now, we're just 6 days away from the election, and I know that you have spent many, many years trying to find the right balance of free speech and moderation on your platform. As we get closer to the election, I know you've made some moves over the last several months, for example, banning the subreddit, the Donald, for example. How do you feel about the community that you've created with now days to go?
You know, we've spent the last not just few months, but number of years refining our policies, learning from all of the lessons that we've seen over the last couple of years. You know, some we've learned the hard way, some we can, you know, have a better sense of what the challenges might be going forward. So based on everything that we've learned and that we know, we feel that we're very well prepared for, you know, the kind of various scenarios that may come up over the next week. But that said, we are watching things very closely. Our communities are watching things very closely. We just sent out a message to our moderators, bringing hopefully them all in on the same page, because really we're all, you know, we're all in this together. And I think that's one of the things that actually makes Reddit special, is that we, our moderators and our users, are all sharing this collective space together.
Meantime, some of your Silicon Valley peers, Jack Dorsey, Mark Zuckerberg, Sundar Pichai, were in the hot seat before Congress today about how they're managing this stuff on their platforms. Take a listen to this heated exchange between Senator Ted Cruz and Jack Dorsey.
Mr. Dorsey, does Twitter have the ability to influence elections?
No.
You don't believe Twitter has any ability to influence elections?
No, we are one part of a spectrum of communication channels that people have.
So you're testifying to this committee right now that Twitter, when it silences people, when it censors people, when it blocks political speech, that has no impact on elections?
People have choice of other communication channels with which—
Not if they don't hear information. If you don't think you have the power to influence elections, why do you block anything?
Well, we have policies that are focused on making sure that more voices on the platform are possible. We see a lot of abuse and harassment, which ends up silencing people and having them leave from the platform.
Steve, what's your reaction to that exchange as one of the competing platforms?
So I think the last thing that Jack said is one of the points that we feel very strongly about as well, which is there are multiple types of speech. And this is one of the things that we spend a lot of time thinking about at Reddit. There's the idea of free speech and open expression, which we feel very strongly about. And there's this other idea that some speech causes other people to feel unsafe and to not speak or to, you know, not feel welcome on our platform. And so it's easy, I think, to talk about hypotheticals when it comes to things like speech. But for us, these are very real trade-offs. And so at Reddit, we have our content policies, you know, that ban things like harassment and bullying and hate and calls to violence. But our communities also have their own rules and their own standards of behavior. And we support them in enforcing those rules, however strict they may be. Because the reality is, in any of these conversations, context is really important and nuance is really important. And one of the things that is unique about Reddit is that our users and moderators all play a critical role in making these difficult decisions.
Do you think that platforms like Twitter, like Reddit, have the power to influence elections? And do you think that Section 230, because of the power of these platforms, should be reformed?
So the first part of your question, I think it really applies to all media companies. And not just media companies, but all media and where people get their information and news. And so I think the platforms play a role in that. Section 230 is a critical law that allows platforms like Reddit and the other platforms to even exist. Without Section 230, we would be forced to one of two extremes. One version is where we are incredibly strict on moderation and very, very limiting, which is what some policymakers do want. The other version is there's no moderation at all and anything goes, which is what other policymakers want. And so the challenge with Section 230 and the frustration that I have watching the hearings today is that it's not even clear what the policymakers want. It's just that they're upset with the status quo and in opposite directions. And so at the moment, Section 230 allows platforms like Reddit to exist in between these extremes and hopefully make good decisions and, you know, over the long term, I think act in the best interest of not just our community, but people generally.
All right. Well, the conversation will most certainly continue. We'll see if it leads to policy change. Reddit CEO Steve Huffman, great to have you back on the show. Thank you so much for stopping by. All right, coming up, foreign interference and election meddling, two issues top of mind just 6 days away from the presidential election. We're going to talk about election security with Kirsten Tope, managing director of the Cyber Readiness Institute and former cybersecurity advisor to President Obama. That's next. This is Bloomberg. Foreign interference is not a new issue, but with less than a week leading up to the U.S. election, American voters are worried that this interference could impact the results. We've learned a lot about foreign players impacting the 2016 presidential election, but has much changed to secure the vote? I want to bring in our electioneering guest for the day, Kirsten Tope, managing director of the Cyber Readiness Institute and former cybersecurity advisor to President Obama. So, Kirsten, what is different about 2020 than 2016? How much progress on this front have we made?
Hi, Emily. It's great to be with you. So we've made a lot of progress from the U.S. government perspective and from industry perspective. Certainly 2016 was a wake-up call. At the end of the Obama administration, elections were identified as critical infrastructure, which meant that the federal government could intervene and provide support and provide resources. And over the last 4 years, you've seen the establishment of the Cybersecurity and Infrastructure Security Agency, specifically responsible for securing our election infrastructure. And you've seen U.S. Cyber Command really up its efforts as well, and our intelligence efforts. And we've also seen industry really do their part. And most recently, a couple weeks ago, we saw the efforts on both U.S. Cyber Command and Microsoft in separate but distinct efforts to disrupt a botnet known as TrickBot, which is one of the world's most prolific distributors of ransomware. So from the straight cyber attacking perspective, we've done a lot better. We've upped our game. Certainly we can expect that our adversaries have upped their game as well, but we're in a better place because of our knowledge, our awareness, and our preparedness than we were 4 years ago.
Exactly. So what are the biggest threats right now on the 2020 election? They are out there, even if we've gotten better at fending them off.
Absolutely. And I think that comes in two categories. We talk about interference and influence. And on the interference side, again, we're consistently seeing our nation state adversaries work against us. But the infrastructure security that we have is in a better place. But what I'm most worried about is influence. And you mentioned it a little bit with your previous guest. But social influence by media, social media influence against our elections is really one of the biggest concerns. The primary vehicle of influence of our elections is social media. And the intent of that influence is to sow discord, is to undermine public faith in our democratic institutions. And those efforts have improved on the part of our adversaries. And we absolutely have to be doing a better job. I'll tell you, it was infuriating to hear 2 days ago, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter talk about the fact that they're going to reconfigure their algorithms post-election to limit disinformation. What that means is that they've had the capabilities all along, but they haven't had the will or the intent. And until they're sort of backed into a corner with legal and regulatory threats, are they going to act? And what this means is that we desperately, the United States government desperately needs to be working with social media as part of our election infrastructure to do better.
Does that mean it's too late and that the damage has already been done or will have already been done on the results? I mean, half of people potentially have already voted.
So there's a difference right now between what's going to happen post-election and pre-election. And truthfully, the best thing we can do is for everybody to get out and vote, because the more people who vote, the more we actually make it difficult for our adversaries to be successful. Right now, again, the election infrastructure, the ability to vote is strong and secure. What we have to make sure of is that we don't share information that we can't validate, that nobody feels suppressed from voting. So we still have the opportunity to manage and to confront that disinformation. And certainly it's a good thing that these social media platforms are doing this after the election. But before the election, the most important piece is for everybody to feel the freedom and the ability to vote. And again, the election infrastructure itself is not vulnerable in a way that we should be worried about. It certainly is prepared for the attacks that are coming at it, but we can be certain that the votes themselves will be counted. We just need to make sure that everybody gets out and votes and isn't persuaded by any disinformation to not vote.
So you think that we can believe the results when we see them?
So this is the biggest issue, right? The integrity of the election. The concern I do have is the perceived compromise of the election. And that's where disinformation comes into play. Again, we have confidence that the election data is going to be secure. But if we have a few districts that have a mishap, and even if our government steps in and addresses that mishap, even just a few counties or districts that, again, have that perceived challenge, a perceived compromise of integrity will absolutely call into question the integrity of the election. And so this is where we as a nation have to listen to the infrastructure elements, the government and what they're doing, as well as the state and local governments, to be sure that what is being done is appropriate. Remember, the goal of our nation state adversaries is to sow discord, is to undermine our public faith. And we have to have confidence in the election infrastructure to know that it's going to be handled appropriately and that we don't fall victim to the social influence.
So what do we need to be most wary of as American citizens in the 6 days leading up to the election and the 6 days following the election?
So we saw last week Iran pose as the Proud Boys and sending out a bunch of emails threatening Democratic voters. I would say to any voter that receives something that in any way suppresses their safety, suppresses their ability to vote, to reach out to your local and state authorities to validate it. So up until the election, it's about anything that prevents people from voting. So we have to make sure that everybody gets out to vote. And I would say it's not the 5 days after the election, it's the 78 days after the election. It's the time between the election day is over, and inauguration that we really have to be paying attention. In 2016, we saw Russia up its efforts on social media disinformation after the election. So we have to be very careful in recognizing what is and is not real. And this is where, again, social media has truly become part of our critical infrastructure. They absolutely have to start acting like it, but government has to be working with them to tell them how to act in the national security concerns of this nation.
Great power comes great responsibility. 78 long days. Okay, I'm going to think about that one. Kirsten Tote, Managing Director at the Cyber Readiness Institute, thank you for being honest with us. Really appreciate you stepping by. Still ahead, a Fitbit rival, Whoop, is having a moment during the pandemic as demand for wellness technology not going away anytime soon. We're going to hear from the company's CEO next. This is Bloomberg. Whoop, the maker of a wearable device that tracks sleep and other health metrics, is valued at $1.2 billion after raising $100 million from investors, including the venture capital firm IVP and the SoftBank Vision Fund, as well as various athletes. This, as other fitness technology companies like Gymshark, Tonal, and Zwift have raised millions of dollars from investors, betting that the home fitness trend will endure on the back of companies like Peloton. Joining us now for more, Whoop CEO Will Ahmed. Will, thank you so much for joining us. So there are other, perhaps more well-known fitness devices out there, whether it's Fitbit or the Apple Watch, Samsung Watch. What do you offer that they don't?
Well, thanks for having me on. You know, I think our mission at Whoop is unique in that we want to unlock human performance. And in particular, our technology, our overall product, is differentiated in that we are able to help individuals improve their health. If you look at people who have been on Whoop for over a year, they're getting more sleep, they're sleeping more consistently, they've got lower resting heart rates, they've got higher heart rate variabilities, and they're making meaningful behavior change. That's the single hardest and most important thing to do in this space, is to change behavior and improve health. And I think fortunately with Whoop and the subscription that we offer, we've been able to demonstrate that.
So talk to us then about how you see what you offer fitting into the broader fitness and home fitness trend. Obviously, we've seen Peloton shares soar. We're seeing gyms shutting down and struggling across the country. What does this new world look like, and what is Whoop's role in it? That's a tongue twister.
I think consumers in general want to take all of this information and put it in their own hands. And I think where Whoop fits in is that we're building a 24/7 life coach to help you understand how all these different things in your life are affecting you. Now, one component of that is obviously exercise. So when you talk about Peloton or Tonal or Mirror or even going to your gym, it's understanding what's the effect of those different classes on your body. But even more broadly, it's understanding diet, it's understanding supplements, it's understanding lifestyle decisions like drinking alcohol or meditating, you know, various things in your life. And what Whoop has gotten very good at is helping you understand how all these different things fit into making you a healthier, higher performing individual. And Whoop in general is appealing to users, I think, who are aspirational. It's not just professional athletes, although we have a lot of those. It's people who want to perform in their daily lives, you know, executives, doctors, cops, firemen, lawyers, people who are aspirational, people who want to be better versions of themselves.
So can you give us any specific metrics or growth targets as we head into the holiday season, which is typically a big time to buy a fitness tracker for someone that you love?
Yeah, over the last 12 months, I mean, the Whoop membership has grown over 5x. So obviously that's quite substantial. Our annual recurring revenue has grown by 380% over that same time period. And we're expecting a strong Q4. We do see right now the demand for health monitoring is about as high as it's ever been, I think. I think that COVID-19 has also created a bit of a paradigm shift, an accelerant, if you will, where people are now realizing they can take health into their own hands. And so, yes, we expect a big holiday season.
So what's your future path? Are you going to be looking for some sort of acquirer like Fitbit did with Google, or do you plan to go it alone?
Well, we believe that Whoop has the potential to be a big standalone business. You know, I think the market for human performance is new and it's growing. And I think Whoop has emerged really as a pioneer in this market for human performance. And because we have a subscription business and we have a long-term value of our customers, we see a lot of potential right now. And with all the growth that we're seeing, and obviously this new round of investment, $100 million, new round of financing. We've got a lot of room to run here. So we do expect to build a meaningful standalone business.
All right. Whoop founder and CEO Will Ahmed, thank you so much for joining us. We'll keep our eye on how the company evolves. And that does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco, Bloomberg Daybreak Australia. coming up next. Also, a programming reminder, tune in to Bloomberg's special election 2020 coverage November 3rd. That starts 7 p.m. Eastern time. This is Bloomberg.